Looking at the world through the sunset in your eyes. Traveling the train through glimmer of the skies. Ducks and pigs and chicken skulls. Animal carpet wall to wall. American ladies 5 foot tall and blue. Sweeping cobwebs from the edges of my mind. Had to get away to see what we could find. Hope the days lie ahead. Bring us back to where they led. Listen not to what's been said to you. Don't you know we're riding on the Marrakesh Express? Don't you know we're riding on the Marrakesh Express? They're taking me to Marrakesh.
It was a very good time for them, and they were having a good time. They had two rules. They had, the one rule was whoever wrote it got the final say, and the other rule was if any of them were having relationship problems with one of the ladies, that we'd just cancel the session and they'd go deal with it. You know, at one point, Stephen went off to New York for a couple of days, you know, with Judy, and they just, they really paid attention to how each other were doing.
There was a sense of you know, a sense of magic, and like, this is really great music. And everybody was stricken by it, you know, not just me, but we, there was just a feeling in the studio, you know, that we all shared, that we knew what we were doing. Because it sounded so good because of Bill Halverson, that we knew that we had something special.
However, the original mixes for the album were very different from the sound that had so captivated the Canyon community. Sensing that Stills, in his enthusiasm, had moved the band from their original course, Ahmet Ertegun directed Atlantic's senior producer Tom Dowd to intervene.
Stephen was really into the band thing. And so when Ahmet originally heard it, it was an acoustic guitar and voices. And when he heard the roughs, it was a lot of band with some voices back in there buried, like sort of was in vogue at that time to sort of bury the vocals. And Ahmet hated it. And so he sent Tommy Dowd out to, you know, basically threaten us. The boys were going to take the night off, and I was going to work with Tommy. And I'm showing him different mixes that we're doing, and he's correcting how to feature the vocals more and to tuck the band in places and everything. And at the end of a few hours, Tommy said, do you think you can manage to get him to do this? And I said, we'll see. And he said, well, I think you can, and you don't need me to do this. And he left. And it was sort of, it sort of hung over our heads. We're either going to pay attention to this perspective, or Tommy will be back. And that's why the vocals are so loud.
On its release in the summer of 69, Crosby, Stills, and Nash made an enormous impact. Famously described by Jimi Hendrix as Western Sky music, the stripped-back, rootsy aesthetic and prominent vocals were lauded by the music press, who were unanimous in declaring that the band had discovered an entirely new sound.
A sound like nobody quite heard before, and yet there was something familiar about it. And of course, we had heard it before. It was three-part harmony. We just hadn't heard it for so long, and certainly not in that context.
There was a lot of space in the music. You could really hear the distance between the guitar at the bottom and the voices up on top, and that's all you needed really. There was just a little bit of bass, not much drums, and that kind of spare clarity was the opposite of where a lot of rock music was going at the time, which was this cumbersome, loud, you know, heavy thing, you know. This was a fresh thing because no one else was doing something with spare acoustic space.
Keep in mind, that record came out, you could not go anywhere in Los Angeles and not hear it, wherever you went. If you went in, whatever store you went into, whoever's house you went into, that record was playing.
Are you thinking of telephone?
Yes, I'm
the manager. Is where you got to be at noon?
Songs that are some of the most poetic and highly lyrical that one has ever heard before. Highly literary in a way that we were unused to, I think, even at that stage. Long run, it will make you cry, make you crazy and old before your time. And the difference between me and you, I won't argue right or wrong, but I have time to cry. There was something powerful about all of the songs they did, and they not only came from the heart, but they had an edge to them. They were masters of the acoustic ballad, but at the same time there was a political edge to their work as well.
That first album is very much the sound of a reaction to the heaviness and violence of 1968. Everything about it, including the famous cover, it's kind of saying, let's get back to something, I suppose, a bit more rustic, but a bit more mellow, a bit more friendly. It's the sound of the canyons, is what it is. And it's the soundtrack for mellowing out in 1969.
With the album climbing the charts, the band turned their thoughts towards touring. The debate about whether to play acoustically or electrically resurfaced, with Stills once again adamant that there should be an electric set. The problem, however, was that since Stills had recorded all the various parts on the album himself, the group didn't have enough players to perform electrically. Requiring both a bassist and someone who could alternate with Stills on lead guitar and keys, a search for musicians began.
After we finished the record, David and Graham went sailing, and finding more musicians was left to Stephen and I. So we flew to London. The one we really wanted was Steve Winwood, and we just scared Steve, Winwood. He locked himself. We were there. We arrived. We had our boots were up to our ankles in mud. And, we were a little under the weather. And we scared Steve Winwood to death. He locked himself in his bedroom and wouldn't come out. And we finally looked at each other and said, well, I guess he's not coming out, and left. We asked Eric Clapton if he wanted to join the band. He said no. And so Stephen asked me, well, what do you think about Neil coming aboard? And I said, isn't he and you the reason that Buffalo Springfield broke up? And he said, nah, it'll be different this time.
And when the suggestion of bringing Neil Young into the band was put to Crosby and Nash, neither were keen. Wary of the arguments that had beset their previous groups, no one was enthusiastic about resurrecting the combustible partnership of Stills and Young. But after several meetings and encouragement from Ahmed Ertegun, a deal was struck for Young to come on board as a full member. Since the collapse of Buffalo Springfield, Young had been busy forging a solo career. And though the two albums he released had been cautiously welcomed by critics, they hadn't made anything like the impact of Crosby, Stills and Nash. For Young, joining the band would mean a dramatic boost in profile.
It upsets the balance of the thing from the point of view of someone like Graham Nash. I mean, Nash is essentially very happy with his two brothers. You know, Nash is quite uneasy about this very complex big personality coming in who has had this history with Stills, and what's he going to do? And Crosby is really quite extroverted. Stills is like a drill sergeant. Nash is a genuinely like decent guy. And then this kind of haunted Canadian enters the fray, and it's sort of like, we all defer to Neil, but what's this gonna do to the chemistry?
Tour rehearsals initially took place at the home of ex-monkey Peter Tork, with former Buffalo Springfield member Bruce Palmer on bass. But as the rehearsals progressed, it became clear that Palmer wasn't the right fit, and the band hired on a young bassist from Motown, Greg Reeves.
Here's what it was. They already had been selling records with their acoustic style of songwriting, record making, singing. But David Crosby's in love with his electric 12-string guitar. And Stephen, you know, he wants to play his white Falcon, Neil with his white Gretsch. So this electric thing was killing them. They wanted to play electrically. They told me, solo on your bass. We want you to rip that thing apart when you're playing our music, just like that. I couldn't believe it. So that's when me and Dallas became important. It wasn't, you didn't have to tone down, because when we were blasting, the police are coming to stop us rehearsing because we blasting the neighborhood out.
On the 16th of August, 1969, Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young played their first ever gig to a paying audience. One day later, they turned out in front of over 400,000 people at the Woodstock Festival in New York. Woodstock turned out to be one of the seminal moments in rock history. And though their equipment went missing, their performance was beset by sound problems, and their audience was assaulted by wind, rain, and mud, CSNY emerged as the counterculture's standard bearers, the embodiment of the Woodstock spirit.
You know, we had no idea what we were getting into, and but we knew that Jimi Hendrix was going to be there. We knew some you know, first-class players were going to be there, and I think David Geffen thought it would be a great career move, or Elliot Roberts, one of the two, or maybe both.
The tension mounted as our equipment continued to not arrive. We had nothing at Woodstock, no instruments. Jimmy was right behind us laughing, may he rest in peace, Hendrix. He was crying laughing. He had this big Gallo cheap wine bottle. He said, you want some? Soothe your pain. And he's crying laughing. He said, you guys don't worry. We got enough instruments and stuff here. You can use my stuff.
Show business was like that for a brief, shining moment.
I mean, everybody that we really thought was good was there. Hendrix, Airplane, Grateful Dead, the band. The band. Did I mention the band? All standing around right behind us.
This is our second gig. This is the second time we've ever played in front of people, man. We're scared shitless.
It was terrible. It was awful. And I remember staying backstage and hearing all these people that were backstage going, these are the least favorite people of each band they're coming from. They'll never make it. We were under the microscope. So what the audience heard seems, you know, okay. In fact, sounded okay on the record. But to me, it was like, oh my God, we're failing miserably.
You know, it wasn't even years later that anybody cared about that. We were awestruck. When you saw these people in mud, so enthused with the music that was being played. I mean, you know, you had all these the great groups, Sly and the Family Stone, man. Come on, man, doing dance to the music up there. Come on. Jimmy, Star Spangled Banner. And even Crosby, Stills, and Nash do that, and Neil do see a madness. It's authentic. All the funky stuff around it, from the bad lighting to the bad sound, that was just, you know.
Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life, you were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes and learn to see all your life. Waiting for this moment to be free. Blackbird fly, blackbird fly into the light of the dark black night. Blackbird singing in the